Hello, friends. Thank you for joining me. Today we're going to take a look at three different books and flip some pages and see what they have. So the first one is the New International Version of the Holy Bible. This is not a version I like or recommend. I think it's in our house because at some point it was the one people wanted used in a course or a Bible study or something like that. This is a relatively, new version of the Bible. It only came around in the 1960s, and the idea behind it is that it's an easy speak that people in then the 20th century could relate to the Bible better if they had that language. So in my mind, and I think the cover bears this out, this Bible is like a pastor who has spiky hair and ripped jeans and believes they're relevant for today. Or some youth pastor who's going to be hip and knows what the kids are thinking. So anyway, I think that's silly. But that's the idea behind this Bible. And it doesn't have very many special features. But we'll take a look at what it does have. You can see really minimal footnotes. Has a very tight binding, so it's a bit hard to open. We're getting to the end. Here's Acts. Paul's epistles. See if we can Oh, here's the first letter of Peter. P-E-T-E-R. And so here is where I actually think this particular one shines. This particular book, I don't know about every NIV, but this table of weights and measures. And what this does is it shows the biblical units of things and what they would be in the ways that we measure things today. Which is very useful, I think. So for instance, a talent is 60 minas. And I think this one's important because many people read the parable of the talents and think it's supposed to be what we mean by talent today. And of course it is not it is a measurement here. So we have talent and mina and shekel. I like the word shekel, which is 2 bekas. And a beka is 10 geras, and then gera. And you can see how they relate. And then here in length, we've got cubits and span and hand breadth, which I think is a cool sounding measurement. So those are the lengths. And then for capacity, we have dry measure and liquid measure. And so we've got a core and a lethic. And I don't know, ifa, I'm not familiar. I'm not actually familiar with any of these. But you can see how they relate to one another. So that's funny, 1/72nd. And then to each other. So you can even see this table is based upon the best available information, but it is not intended to be mathematically precise. It's just kind of close. And so here it talks about how to read and enjoy the Bible. It's so funny to me that you would say that to people. But it says, many people assume that the Bible's language is too difficult for the average person to understand. I don't know who assumes that. Others are a little frightened by the Bible's size. And some people just don't expect to find anything in the Bible that applies to the needs and problems of men and women in the 20th century. The Bible you hold in your hand is a modern translation of the ancient Hebrew and Greek scriptures. It's easy to understand. Contemporary English puts the message of the Bible in the language of the average person. I would just maybe be wary of some of the translations in here. So here, it talks about verses for different things. And it's interesting, they're mostly all negative. Insecurity, worry, anxiety, discouragement, loneliness, temptation, guilt, suffering, and then at the end, living a full life. So I do like that this one has the verses right for you, but I think the section kind of like this in the Good News Bible covers a lot more things, but of course in that one you have to go look up the verses yourself. Here's a part of where you can find certain things like the Lord's Prayer, the Prodigal Son. And then this particular one has 2 maps. So we have Palestine at the time of Christ. Both of the maps are New Testament. And so as always, we have this so important Jordan, the River Jordan. And here's the Sea of Galilee. And we go down, down, down. I think I said River Jordan. Jordan River. And to the Dead Sea. You know, so much of the water in this area is salty and just shows you how important any fresh water would be. Got the coastline. There are so many names on here that we still hear today. Again, is why I think the Bible and truly all great literature, all great philosophies are relevant in all time. We've got Damascus, and let's see what else have we got. Jerusalem, of course, Gaza, Let's see the other one. So in this one, we've got the world of the New Testament Church, and it shows the extent of the Roman Empire. Look how big this was. This was a time, you know, when getting around places was hard. They didn't quite have this area. Or maybe they didn't quite have this area. So here's Rome. And here's all of their empire. Again, we've got Jerusalem here. And then, you know, places you hear about in the Bible, like Philippi, the letter to the Philippians, or Ephesus with the letter to the Ephesians. Look, there's Philadelphia. And here's the Black Sea. I like this word, Cappadocia. 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 So anyway, that's this Bible. Now let's take a look at this book, which is not a Bible. So this book is Jesus of Nazareth. It's my Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, who of course now is Pope Benedict XVI. And this one has raised letters. And of course, here we have an artist's rendition of our Lord Jesus, right here. And all these neat swirly designs. They look like leaves and floral items, but they're not really. Shapes can give impressions. And so if we flip this here, we can see again the same raised letters. So pretty. And then on the back, I got this book for $5 at a used bookstore, so quite a deal. Here we have the Pope, I mean the former Pope, now it's Pope Francis, Pope Emeritus Benedict. And I just love this. This book is my personal search for the face of the Lord, Benedict XVI. And if you're not familiar with Pope Benedict, he is an incredibly intelligent, and highly educated man. He speaks multiple languages and has written many papers. And books, of course, but that is reflected in this book because it is very dense. This is not an easy book or a warm fuzzy. It is scholarly and academic. It is full of references. And it doesn't really have any neat features. The only thing it has that isn't the book itself is the bibliography in the back. And so if you're wondering just how scholarly this is, here's, you know, pages and pages of references in the bibliography. These ones that aren't reduced to a particular chapter. And then we do have some definitions, which is important, because some of the stuff in here, the very technical term matters for what he's trying to say. But see, he uses words like Babylonian Talmud. There's other ones, let me see. Eschatological, eschatology, which is doctrine about or content of the end times, refer also to the ultimate truth and fullness, refers also to the ultimate truth and fullness Christ brings us as the kingdom of God in person. And then I wanted to, there's one more word in here, hermeneutic, pertaining to interpretation here of scripture, and I forget that one all the time. It's a word I have to keep looking up. You can see there's Greek and Latin. So anyway, it's taking me a long time to get through this. You can see where I appear. I take breaks from it. But to see someone going after the truth or read it with such a scholarly and clear mind and with such great attention to facts is really great. I also just really like this font and the spacing between lines and even the little detail down here. It's like a sconce on a page. It's a very pleasant size book and weight book. Feels nice. Oh, here we go. So, this jacket painting here is by, and I'm sorry, I'm not very good at, I think this is a Dutch name, Joost van Cleef, who I think was alive from 1485 to 1540, and I'm not even going to try, it's in a museum. Réunion des Musées Nationaux, I think is what it's called. So anyway, this is a nice book. Good for tracing and sound. You can hear the paperweight in here is so heavy. Very different. Notice Bibles tend to have thinner paper, and I think it's because it's such a thick book. You have to deal with weight and binding. Okay. So we can finish with this one. Now for something totally different. And this book is War and Peace by Tolstoy. And it is the book I am reading right now. And it's funny, I've tried to read this a couple other times, and I just did not enjoy it. I had trouble following it. As you can see, it is very long. That's the joke about War and Peace, right? And there's a lot to keep track of. And it gives a lot of characters the same names. So you gotta pay really close attention. But this time, I'm absolutely loving it. I don't know why. And I think maybe, perhaps, it's the translation. Maybe this is a better translation. But this one has some great resources in it. So let me share them with you. These are the different books that come in this series. These are thin pages too, but look how tiny this text is. So this tells you about Leo Tolstoy. You want to know about the author. And so here's where these resources start that make it easier. So the contents. If you want to know more about what's in the various parts, and this one large book is divvied up into smaller books, but this tells you about each chapter. If you wanted to go back for reference or wondered where something happened, you can find it easily. So you see how many books. Here's book 9. 10 is a long one. Look at all the chapters. I haven't gotten that far yet. Let's see. Book 11. Book 12. Book 13. Book 14. Book 15. And then, much like Count of Monte Cristo, got these epilogues. Though I think in one of the translations that I read, actually, there were extra appendices, but it's because they had taken chunks out of the book that they didn't think mattered to the story. So here, oh, I'm thinking of Les Miserables, not Count of Monte Cristo. So here's the maps. We'll look at those in a minute. But let me show you the best resource. And that is the principal characters arranged in family groups. So you can see here the different families and who's in each. When I take my bookmark out, I put it here, so I can just keep going back to this page, and it has made a huge difference. A huge difference. It's been really interesting. I will say, when you have a book this long, It naturally has long and detailed storylines that go in different directions, and so parts of it I can't get enough of, and parts of it I'm kind of getting through, till I get back to the parts I like more. So this is about Russia's war with France, when Napoleon was in France, one of the times, and there's a lot of mixing of French and Russian. For instance, the main character is named Pierre, and then you get things like Nicholas and Peter, Natasha, who goes by Natalie. Let's see, like here, these are the main families, right? We've got a Nicholas and a Nicholas, and then in this other family we've got a Nicholas. Now this one makes sense, of course, because, you know, the son was named after his father, but okie dokie. It makes it a little confusing when you're going through. So anyway, here's the story. So you can see book one, and then there's the chapter. Here's my bookmark. This is as far as I am. I won't spend too terribly long flipping through this. Plus, I don't want to ruin it for me. But we'll get back here. Finally made it to the epilogues, everyone. Let's see, what page does this first epilogue start on? Epilogue is a whole book in its own. So page 645. So now we come to these great maps. So we've got the Battle of Austerlitz. Look at the forest, it has the little trees. Here's Austerlitz. A lot of big lakes on this river. And then here we've got the War of 1805. Bohemia and Bavaria. And Moravia. They sound so cool. And especially Bohemia, right? Bohemians. And then, of course, Austria and Hungary, which we have today. Here's the Danube. And then we've got the advance and retreat of Napoleon in 1812. Here's Prussia and the Duchy of Warsaw. Isn't that funny? Duchy? Duchy? See things you recognize like Minsk. A lot of these books I notice in this time, French and Russian, are, I guess you'd call them historical fiction. You know, with all historical characters, but they're built around some of these real things that happened, especially battles or the French Revolution. And so when they're describing them, which in some cases they do very realistically, having gone off, you know, war notes, it's very helpful to be able to see So here's Moscow. Here's the Kremlin and the palace. Look at the river. You don't get many civilizations that aren't near a river. That way to St. Petersburg, that way to Crimea. So that does it for our map. So thank you for joining me. I hope that you enjoyed these. And I'll see you again soon.